Hello, I'm David Rubenstein, the president of the Economic Club of Washington, and welcome to this broadcast. Today we had intended to have a live in-person interview of Joe Kaeser, who is the president of Siemens, Siemens USA and Siemens Global. And he is not coming to the United States today, and therefore we have had a decision to do something else. And we did the same thing, we decided to do the same thing with two other programs that we have. Next week we were going to have a program with Alex Gorsky, who is the CEO of Johnson & Johnson. And on April the 1, we were going to have a program with Robert Smith, who is the head of Vista, a large private equity firm based in Texas. We decided instead to postpone those programs and just instead to do something virtual, which we're going to do today with a number of leaders of the organizations in Washington, academic organizations, business organizations, trade associations. We thought it would be helpful to the members to see what others are doing to deal with the coronavirus, and also to see what they're doing with respect to their employees and their shareholders or other people who are of interest to them. And so we're going to start with Sylvia Mathews Burwell, who is the president of American University. Subsequent to her, we'll have David Scorton, who is the president and CEO of the Association of American Colleges. After David, we'll have Joanne Jenkins, who's the CEO of the American Association for Retired Persons. Subsequent to that, we'll have Peter Scher, who is the Mid-Atlantic chairman of J.P. Morgan Chase. After Peter, we'll have Roger Krone, who's the chairman and CEO of Leidos. And after that, we'll have Matt Kelly, who's the CEO of J.B.G. Smith, the largest real estate company in this area. So why don't we just start with Sylvia, and just give you a little bit of her background. Sylvia is a native of West Virginia, went to Harvard, Rhodes Scholar, got her degree at Oxford, came back, got involved with the administration of Bill Clinton, and served under Bob Rubin in the administration of Bill Clinton, and ultimately went to work at the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, head of the president of global development there, and also after about 10 years there, became the head of the Walmart Foundation. And if that wasn't enough for her career, she then came back to be the head of OMB under President Obama, and later became the head of Health and Human Services under President Obama, and now she's the president of American University. And she's only 20 years old. So, Sylvia, thank you very much for doing this morning. I know you've got a number of things to do at American University that are going to take a lot of time, so we won't take too much of your time. But is American University closed now or not?
Thank you, David, for having me. And right now, our university is open. We have moved to online.
Okay.
And I think that's an important thing in terms of continuing our mission as a university. Next Wednesday, our students are on spring break. We've asked them not to come back, but we will move our courses to online. And as of Monday, we will be encouraging all those that can do teleworking to telework in terms of the university. But we will be functioning and moving against our mission.
All right. Was it a difficult decision to do this? And did you meet with your board of trustees? How did you come about with this decision?
You know, this decision, I believe, was the right decision. We made it very early this week. I did communicate with my board. In a university, we communicated broadly in terms of making sure that our deans were a part of helping us understand what would be the ramification of that. Our leadership team contributed as we made that decision.
Okay, so students, I assume every student today, when I was in college, we didn't have computers. Everybody has a computer, so everybody can do this online. There's no problem with some people say they don't have computers, right?
You know, there are a very limited number, but there are some students, and so we need to take care of and account for that in terms of thinking through how we make sure that students can have that access. At American University, we have programs through our library that do loaners, and what we are doing as we make this transition is ensuring that we have a place for our students who may have challenges. Either challenges in departing, whether that's because perhaps you live in a level three country that you don't want to go back to, or other challenges with regard to doing it. So we have a means by which students can let us know what their challenges are, and in a retail way, we need to work those through.
Well, let's suppose I'm in a level three country. Let's suppose I'm in a country where I can't go back to it, let's say, or I can't afford to go back to it. Can I live in my dorm, or the dorms are closed as well?
So that's why, David, I said when you asked the question, is the university closed? The university is not closed. We think that there will be a small number of exceptions to the policy that we have put in place. And we needed to do this because as a university, and I think we're seeing it all over the country, whether it's the NBA, Walt Disney, everything, getting to a place where we de-densify. You take away the density because that does two things. That one reduces the chance of spread of a very transmittable virus. And the second thing it does is in terms of burden on systems in when we get to the place where we have more cases. Things like in a university setting, self-isolation.
Do you have any individuals yet who have contracted this virus that you're aware of?
We do not yet. In terms of that, our healthcare, we've sent out information so that students know how to contact and call our system if they have questions.
Okay, so the professionals who work at the university, they are coming to work now or they're working from home?
Right now, we are moving to telework on Monday, though we did announce yesterday that our high-risk populations, that we encourage them to telework as of today. Those high-risk populations being those that are immunocompromised, those high-risk populations are generally those over 60, and those high-risk populations are those that are pregnant. So any of the CDC categories of high risk, we've encouraged them to telework today.
So since you've announced these policies, have anybody said, well, you're overreacting or you shouldn't have done this?
You know, I think generally there is an understanding there that why we need to do this. I think we and a number of other large companies were at the first part of this at the beginning of the week, but things are moving so quickly. When you have the Ohio Health Department announcing that they think there are 100,000 cases in the state of Ohio, I think people are seeing why we're making these choices and decisions.
Okay, let me finish up about American University before I go to your HHS experience. On American University today, it's your expectation this will continue through the end of this spring semester. Is that correct?
Right now, what we have done is we have said that our students will be online till the end of the semester. A part of that is trying to consider for students and their families what it would be like to move back, and our faculty. So what we want to do is execute well against mission and make sure that after a three-week period, that we continue on the online. And so our students will finish online.
All right. As the head of the university, you're the symbol of the university, obviously. So you want to remain healthy. So what are you doing to keep healthy and make sure you don't get this virus?
Well, I think you probably noticed, David, when we met and we met with the others that were out there, that I did not shake hands. I am even beyond the place where I'm doing what I refer to as the Ebola elbow bump. I think we all need to do the social distancing. And social distancing, CDC has guidelines generally recommended between 4 and 6 feet. The clear washing of the hands, making sure that anytime anyone coughs or sneezes, that you really are doing one of two things. Using your elbow or using a tissue to catch the droplets that are coming out. All the things, the hand washing, extremely important, and that is 20 seconds and with soap.
Now, you are a member of the Board of the Council on Foreign Relations, and at the recent board meeting, we had a very interesting conversation that you were involved with other people who were on the board who are also former members of the cabinet. They served as the head of the Homeland Security. You were the head of HHS. So, in your view, what can the United States be doing now that isn't doing to deal with this crisis?
So I think the response, everyone needs to understand that when we get to this level, and it's a global pandemic at this point, that everyone has a role and needs to participate in the response. At the federal government level, there are two things that the government needs to do, and that is, one, make sure that the tools are ready for a response, and that includes everything from testing to making sure that our healthcare system has the equipment and tools that it needs to do that, and communicating the broad guidance so that institutions, and whether those are governors or heads of large companies or heads of universities, have those things to act and react. But the reaction will be on the ground, as we're seeing across the country as well.
Have you seen anything like this in your experience as a healthcare professional before? Anything where the United States had this kind of virus?
So we have had epidemics. We've had H1N1, which was the last at this level. We have had Ebola come to our shores. What is distinct about this is right now, in terms of the level of transmittability and our lack of knowledge at this point in time in terms of how many cases we actually have. And because we don't know through the testing, we actually don't know for certain what the mortality rate is. So there are a number of unknowns that are unique to this, but the basic things we need to think about: prevention, detection, response, containment, and mitigation still hold.
Now, for the flu, it is said that the mortality rate is 0.1% on average flu. Here it is suggested it may be 10 times as high as that or something like that. Well, we don't know because we don't know how many cases there really are yet. Is that right?
That's correct.
And the people who are older, you were kind enough to not suggest that, say that I'm one of the people who are in potential trouble, but people who are 60 or older have a much higher fatality rate. Is
yes.
that right? And why is that? Is that because their immune system is so much weaker?
I don't think we actually fully understand the science of that yet. I think one of the things about this particular COVID-19, the novel 19 coronavirus, is that it seems that the virus attaches to the lungs more quickly, whereas other viruses attack different parts of the respiratory system. And as we know, the lungs are one of the most important and potentially vulnerable issues. So I don't think we know exactly the science of why we have more mortality in an upper age range.
Right. Do we know why young people do not seem to have a high fatality rate or not contracting as much? Kids don't seem to be getting it. Why is
that? So we have a situation where the lack of information that is related to the testing issue is quite challenging. If you go to the Washington State website, which I think has some of the best information on testing, they've tested over 3,000 in the state of Washington and 366 cases. If you look at the percentages, I added them up just to see, and 41% of the cases are in people under 60. So part of this is we don't actually know. I think we do know that the most dangerous categories are those which have been articulated, that there is certainty about the science, but other things and more information, it's hard right now.
Now, you were the head of HHS during the Ebola crisis.
Yes.
Right? So how is this different than Ebola? Ebola was fairly fatal if you got it. But not as many people got it. So how would you contrast that with this?
So when you think about a virus, you want to think about transmittability and mortality are two of the most important, and there are other things that come under that that are extremely important. But the issue of mortality, when Ebola started and we started working on it, the mortality rate was 90%. So there was 90% chance you would die if you got Ebola. That went down, and when we were treating in systems like our own in the U.S., that went down. It didn't go down below 50%, right. But it did go down. And so that's a difference. The mortality rate is lower here, but the transmissibility is higher. If you'll remember, Ebola passed through actual bodily fluids. This is actually can be carried in terms of when you sneeze, and so it's the air droplets. And so the transmittability is much higher for this.
Now, some people say that this disease virus survives on, let's say, a hard surface for, I don't know, it could be 3 hours, 10 hours, we don't really know. But so how can you really know that you're not going to get it just if you go to, let's say, a Starbucks, and how do you know the counter is clean? How do you prevent this?
So I think everyone is starting to practice the really good deep cleaning and continued cleansing. What I would recommend for everyone is making sure that, again, you are doing that hand washing, and also wherever you are that you're washing. Also think very carefully about touching things that many people have touched. When you go into a restroom, if you're going into a public restroom, use a tissue or a napkin to open the door, to turn on the faucets, any of those kinds of things where you think other people would have been touching. That's one way to try and deal with the fact that people could be touching and it does live on surfaces.
So let's conclude and let you go back to American University. One final question. So what is your estimate of how long we're likely to be in this kind of environment? It could be 30 days, 60 days, 90 days, or we just don't know?
I think we don't know, but the one thing we do know is that our response at this moment and all the steps that people are taking that feel extreme will both do two things. They will limit that timetable you just described, David. And the second thing that they will do is they will limit how bad it gets in terms of numbers of cases. And that's why I think everyone across the country you see, whether it's the NBA or bringing down March Madness or what universities are doing or companies are doing, is so important to answering that question. It will make it shorter and it will make the peak lower.
Sylvia, thank you very much for giving us your time, and wish you the best in leading American University through this crisis. Thank you.
David, thank you for having me.